Good evening, everybody. Welcome to today's edition of Clarity Through Debate. The agenda before us are emerging trends in the housing sector. Are our land norms geared to meet today's challenges? We have a very illustrious panel with us today to debate. We have Om Chaudhary, CEO of Fire Capital. We have Romy Roy, Senior Consultant with UTIPEC DDA, and Urban Planner, forgot to add that. And we have Manish Kashyap on my left, MD C.B. Richard Ellis, and finally we have Mr. Rohtas Goel, CMD OMAX. The most controversial issue now is land acquisition, and we have seen it play out in Noida very frequently over the last 1 year. And Noida, frankly, is a middle class El Dorado, because a lot of middle class have found a great home to live here. But all of a sudden, that dream seems to be dissipating. The government, on its part, has come up with a land acquisition bill, which seeks to do a balance between the two key stakeholders, the farmers from whom the land is being acquired and the developers on the other side. I'm very curious to see how the developers see this point of view. Do you agree that it strikes a fine balance, Rohtas?
I really, welcome the land acquisition bill. But, as it is, land acquisition bill is fatal to the industry. Land acquisition bill says that 6 times of the rate, market rate in rural areas and 2 times in urban areas. I'm not only talking about real estate. If you talk about industry, institutional, hospitals and colleges, nobody will be able to acquire the land from the farmers. If today's rate is 50 lakh rupees an acre, that means the government is asking us that you buy at 3 crore rupees an acre, 6 times rate. Why the government is saying this, as I have listened from some people at many forums, government says that the market rates or the circle rates are always below the market rates. That is why we have capped it 6 times rate, or they are trying to make it 4 times. I request the government, make the circle rate at par with the market rate. If the circle rate is at par with the market rate, then what is the need of making 6 times or 4 times or 2 times?
I'm very keen to know, Manish, what do you think? Do you concur with him or do you disagree?
I think, Rohtas's point about paying 4 times or 6 times, whatever the final case might be, for acquisition of land is obviously a very important one, and I think the government needs to look at it carefully, because, like you said, it will inhibit growth and the process of land acquisition for anyone trying to do any business, let alone real estate. I think there are some very good provisions in there. Rehabilitation and resettlement is a big part of the new land acquisition bill, which I think is in keeping with the way it should be done. And a lot of the money that they are talking about giving the farmers in the land acquisition bill is in some sort of a way a delayed gratification, where all the money is not given to them upfront, but given to them over a period of time.
Yeah.
So things like that are, I think, very positive.
But now, do you think it addresses, like Rohtas has clearly said, he's got concerns on the whole bill. But since the farmer is not present on this panel, let me be the devil's advocate that I am unhappy. So how do you deal with me?
It's a difficult call, because, I think that the bill needs to be looked at in totality and not only the number as far as the acquisition price is concerned. And then there is issues like consent of 80% is required before, which we think will bring down litigation. At the moment there is a lot of litigation because consent of the people or the parties was not there. So largely speaking, the bill addresses a lot of the issues that are concerns for industry and farmers. Obviously, when you're trying to get a balance, there will be parts which will make both sides unhappy.
Okay. How do you see it? Because you're juggling funders and you're generating the resources for the developers.
This economy, one of the engines of growth is going to be development, construction is required. So if you're going to get to a 10% GDP growth rate, which is what we aspire to, we have no option but to push urban development forward. We are a services-centric economy. Unless urban infrastructure is in place, we fall short. So in order to make that happen, land is the raw material. Fortunately or unfortunately, land in India is a highly emotive subject. you know, whether it's you or me at a personal level or a bunch of farmers, it is emotive and therefore highly explosive. And India is a democracy, so this bill, it's nothing but, I wouldn't say that it's something that we or the government is forced to do, but you know, that's what people at large, farmers at large who own land, are pushing for, and that is a response to that need. If you look at it from the development standpoint, you know, it is, the proof of the pudding is going to be in the eating. We are not going to get the desired results.
Om, if I read the subtext, you seem to be unhappy with the provisions of the bill. We'll leave it there. I'll rephrase my question to the three of you, and I'll bring in Romy too. My question is this the end of the dream for middle class to own a house?
You know, I'm not an expert on policy and land acquisition and all of that. But I must say one thing. I think the most important thing from a developer's perspective and as well as Om's perspective is the easiest way to ease pressure and create more housing for the middle class and, you know, everybody else is ensuring that there is enough supply of land and enough construction going on. I was just talking to Rohtas before this, and you know, in spite of, you know, when you drive around Gurgaon today, you see this tremendous amount of construction going on, and everyone assumes why are prices still going up. The fact of the matter is, there is 4 million square feet of commercial leasing happening in Gurgaon every year, year on year, which is creating 40 to 45,000 new jobs every year, year on year. A thumb rule that we use globally is that for every 100 square feet that you have for office, a new office that has been created, you need to create 500 square feet of residential. You know, because many people won't buy, some people will buy a 4,000 square feet apartment, someone will buy 1,500 square feet. So when you average it out, you know, they use a 500 to 600 square feet, you know, model. Which means in Gurgaon, year on year, you need to create 20 to 25 million square feet of residential. There just isn't enough coming up.
Stay with us. We'll be back after a break. Welcome back. So now, I mean, I think you alluded to the word affordable housing. I'm just wondering if affordable housing is the way out of this complex battle where, you know, the government has a problem. It's balancing two interests. Farmers can't be wished away, developers can't be wished away, and you have this consumer whose expectations rise every day. So Romy, as an urban planner, you're a little removed from this. So how do you see this?
Definitely, I don't know the details of this bill and everything, but how we want to see growth. Firstly, we don't want to see untended sprawl happening in the city. So just taking land and then keeping on building at 2 FAR, 1.2 FAR, is not what we should be doing, because that is inefficient use of land. That's one thing.
You mean the compact, I mean,
it's not
the bungalow kind of houses.
Bungalow or even G+2, or, you know, that's too less for a country which is, we need agricultural land to be preserved. Every country needs it. So we need certain amount of density that should be inbuilt in our bylaws, which currently is not, because our norms actually promote low density housing, low density development. So that's a problem. And the other thing is that what another issue that comes up is what should be the criteria for acquiring land. One is industry, okay, but the acquisition of land for commercial housing and general growth for people to live, work and play, there needs to be infrastructure in place, which I think you were alluding to. We need a transport system to be in place. In NCR, in NCT, I can talk more about NCT, which is Delhi. We have done so much housing in Bhavana and Narela and other areas, and there is no basic infrastructure there. Even Dwarka has no water, there's no proper bus systems, there are no proper roads, there are no proper, metro is now going, and you know, like when we are pushing and building the so-called affordable housing in the outskirts of the city, we are actually making the poor poorer, because they have to spend 100 rupee, 50 rupee every day, which earlier they could do for free, they could cycle.
Now, we do concur on one thing, that we need affordable housing. Let me put the moose on the table. Are we looking at, is going vertical an option? You know, relaxing the FSI norms in a place like Delhi. Like, I would have loved to live in a Connaught Place, you know, beautiful neighborhood, but you can't afford it. So, if the government of India relaxed FSI, does it excite you? to go vertically?
Government of India, before relaxing FSI, it has to release the land which he has locked, more than 1 lakh acre of land in Delhi itself.
True.
In Delhi itself. You are talking about increasing of FAR, increasing of FSI. You have locked more than 1 lakh acre of land in Delhi. Please unlock that land.
Where?
Then talk about, this is in Delhi.
You're talking about the urban extension.
Yes, this is in Delhi. And the master plan is there, you are not releasing that. And you are talking about affordable housing. You are making metros from Delhi to Noida, Delhi to Gurgaon, but not, you are locking your stock. And talking about increasing FAR. Yes, increasing FAR should be there. FSI should be 4 everywhere. If you make FSI 4, I was talking that 3% of land is required to urbanize, to give everybody in India homes. Everybody. 3% of entire land of India. If you make FAR 4, just 1% of land is required. This is the fight of just 1% of land. And you are controlling this land by land acquisition bill, by this and that and that.
Rotas, just hold, if you could, before you answer this, can you really go vertical without getting the infrastructure, etc. in place? Please answer that too, along with this question.
No,
about
actually the government's job is to provide infrastructure. So we have to provide the infrastructure. Land can be released in many ways. It's not just acquisition of agricultural land. It's also inside the city. There are a lot of low development colonies. There are slums. There are low development, low-rise government colonies. Delhi is a very low-density, low-rise city. So there is a lot of land inside the city. And of course, we need land outside the city as well. And I think DDA acquires land and then auctions it. They have a system of doing that.
Manish?
Why DDA land acquires for auctioning?
Yeah, I don't know.
Why?
I'll get back to you on that.
DDA should acquire land for their own development.
Yeah.
If they auction, please don't auction. Let the developer buy the land directly from the farmers.
No, she's. You were saying in
Jameen ko afim banake mat bechiye aap.
Manish, where do you stand on this debate?
I think I concur with Romy on the point that Delhi, by most standards, with the pressure of population, etc., now is considered very low density, and it's. If you really look at. Delhi is a city now, and Delhi, it's unfair to really call it Delhi anymore, you know, it's the NCR region. It's become too much of a sprawl, you know, from Ghaziabad and Noida on one side to Gurgaon on the other side, and then North Delhi, which is all the way up to Kundli now.
You think this will make sense to investors, this idea that Romy is, I think they're executing it, they're acquiring land along the metro corridor, and for mixed land use, makes sense?
No, I think this is globally also, a phenomena where people are now moving away from sprawl. You know, the United States, for example, has seen sprawl like nowhere else. Los Angeles is, you know, case in point. Now they're all trying to move back to a situation where they could walk to work, mm-hmm. and you know, the city is redesigned, redeveloped.
Compact.
It's more compact. Now, so that is not just a phenomenon that. Would be germane to India, but you know, is globally. But having said that, we also have to look at what the state of play is in terms of basic infrastructure, whether it's, you know, sewage, water, and when we look at going vertical, increasing densities, the practicality of achieving that is also something that you have to keep in mind. Yes. Mm-hmm. You know, if you look at area under roads in Delhi, it puts most other cities to shame, right? It's lavish. So there is a logic to saying, you know, there is a lot of open area, low densities, we could create that. But, you know, like most things in life, you have to be practical. Here again, we will have to be practical to see how much. You know, there are examples like in Singapore where redevelopment has kind of changed the city entirely. Can we do that? We'll have to see. The other dimension which we have to look at is increasingly with affluence, people are looking for better lifestyle. Now, that lifestyle, is it going to be possible? If you want membership to a club, you want place to park your cars, you know, most of our cities were designed for scooters and at best one car. Now, parking. You know, these are issues.
But if
that
you go vertical, you'll fix that problem. Like in Manhattan, you don't buy a car. So you use the subway or you walk or whatever.
Yeah,
so
but culturally,
there's another point. You know, going vertical doesn't mean you convert your existing colonies into vertical. So, you know, what used to be a 2.5-story home, now they're allowing 4 stories there. Without any improvement in the roads, everything is the same, and you've just allowed every home to put up 2 more floors. That isn't the answer. That is not what I mean by vertical.
That's dangerous, actually.
It has to be planned vertical.
No, that's assumed.
I think, Anil, I just want to take up Om's point, and I think there is our problem. I agree with him. LA is a bigger sprawl than the national capital region. But there are inherent problems in the way the city of Delhi travels, which compounds the problem, which LA doesn't have. If you live in the US and if you live in LA, every child goes to the same school district.
Correct.
You know, there is one school, and every kid who lives in that community goes to that school. In Delhi, Vasant Vihar has 22 schools, and there are many colonies which have no schools. So you are traveling, crisscrossing the city day in and day out, all the kids are crisscrossing. So the problems are accentuated in many other ways, which because of the planning and the way the things are in those cities, even though it's a bigger urban sprawl, you know, the children are all going to neighborhood schools.
Correct. It's basically what we need is, you know, what Bangalore is trying to do. You know, they have the STRR where they're looking at all the satellite towns around Bangalore, and then, you know, it's more like a hub and spoke model. So you will need to create, and Delhi also, if you look at the district centers and that concept, it was initially designed in a way where you would live close to your place of work. But that didn't happen. And, you know, to Manish's point, schools, for example, there were certain parts where all the schools came up, and the more, you know, prestigious schools where everyone wanted to send their children to. So, you know, there are, you know, you need to work traffic around school timing, right? Which never happens in, you know, most cities in the world.
Stay with us. We'll be back after the break. Welcome back. We are discussing today the emerging trends in the housing sector. Are our land norms geared to meet today's challenges? Very interesting, because I think from what all of you are saying, that we are reaching a situation where this one stakeholder, which we have, is not present on the panel, the consumer, has to now make choices. Like what you said about commuting to work or sending your kids to neighborhood schools, to districts. So as an urban planner, and you know India now extremely well, handling in DDA, do you see one example in India where we are following these best practices? And if you would, I mean, you are trying to fix Delhi. Are you optimistic, or do you think these ideas that we discussed can be executed in a place like Delhi?
Actually, the way I look at it is that we have no choice. We have to make it work, because we cannot let our low-income population keep living in slums. We cannot have our PM levels, the particulate matter pollution levels in Delhi, I think they are second highest in the world. And they are, I think, 3 times above acceptable human levels, human health levels. So if we go with the current way we are going, we will all die, basically. It will be like Akbar's city, no? You just leave the city and go.
But do we take down those walls? Does it make sense for you as a developer to create a livable community where you'll have mixed community? You'll have low cost, you'll have high, you'll have commercial establishments. So you basically have a life, what we call downtown. I mean, I'm sure all of us dream to have a downtown in India. We don't have a downtown, whether it's Bombay or Delhi. Connaught Place is a place you would avoid at night. You wouldn't want to be alone out there. And now anyway, the way they have dug it up, even the brave won't go there. So, but assuming that we do have this circumstance, do you as a developer see a fiscal incentive?
This is already there. If you talk about Sonipat, if you talk about Bahadurgarh, you talk about Gurgaon, you talk about Faridabad, and you talk about Noida and Greater Noida. This facility is already there.
I didn't see it in Gurgaon.
Yes, this is already there. And in Haryana also, if you make an integrated township, you got commercial 4%, you got institutional, you got residential, everything is there. Only in Delhi, you know, in Delhi, this kind of development has not been happened till today. If Delhi, 1 lakh acre, more than 1 lakh acre is land is, you know, unlocked, and more than 100 acre or more than 25 acre land should be allowed to develop, not 1 acre, 0.5 acre or 2 acres, then definitely, yes, the master plan will allow that, yes, this much residential is there, this much commercial, this much institutional, this much is, I mean, hospital and this thing. This is already there.
I think even in Delhi, you know, to be fair to the planners who did this in Delhi, if you look at any colony, and you know, my parents live in Greater Kailash, it has a market, it has a temple, it has a club, it has, you know,
a local shopping area.
And if you really look at most of the colonies, it was planned for. You know, what it has become is a different matter.
No, Manish, that is for a limited population. Today, Delhi's population has exploded at the NCR, as you call it, rightly. So how do you fix it? See, that was the old India. You had a very limited population. You had huge inequalities of income, etc. So you could afford that. Like you had Sujan Singh Park and you have Khan Market. I know what you mean. But in today's
Can I explain this actually? Yeah. It's slightly technical. But earlier the master plan was, it's currently also, the master plan provides commercial uses based on population. So for every 10,000, you need this much commercial, this much civic, whatever. Now what we are discussing is denser development, because earlier Delhi was very low density. There was no immigration before the Commonwealth Games, the rate at which we've seen immigration in the last 10 years, 20 years. So now the moment that 10,000 earlier was like an omelette, it was spread around on the land, and like the yolk of the omelette, you had the commercial in the center and everybody was supposed to walk to the commercial, and that was enough to serve that omelette. Now when you're going higher or denser, which is what we are debating, the 10,000 will probably be in 2 buildings or 5 buildings. So immediately what happens is your commercial is now on the ground floor of your building. It's no longer in the omelette form. So what happens is that you have a lot of buildings and you have commercial and mixed use and civic and churches and everything on the ground floor or the first floor. So it's not that we are changing any law, we are just changing the way the city, the morphology of the city, the form of the city is going to change when you go denser.
If you look at city after city in the north, the south, you know, a lot of our cities are, you know, they're not 20, 30 year old,
yeah.
You know, they're 100, 200, 300 year old cities. So, you know, we talk a lot about redevelopment, but if somebody were to go look for sewerage plans for the city of Delhi, I don't think anybody can pull that out. So, you know, these are practical problems that, you know, we have to live with.
Thank you, everybody. That was an extremely lively discussion. Please keep watching Men's Clarity Through Debate.